this time we'll tackle the topic of momentum. And this is, if this looks like a homework assignment, it's because it is. Without further ado, let's get right into it. Let's first look at what motion is. Motion is the displacement of an object over an amount of time. For example, if I let go of this, it moves towards my hand. And because of inertia, it is an object once in motion tends to remain in motion, often with disastrous results. La inercia no es una fuerza, es una propiedad que está presente en todos los cuerpos, incluyéndolo a él. Y dado que la tendencia de mantener el movimiento es una característica aplicada a la masa, es por lo tanto directamente proporcional a ella, como lo demuestra la dama.
La cantidad de movimiento es simplemente el producto de la masa y la velocidad de un objeto dado, y se conserva entre cualquier conjunto de cuerpos en colisión o cualquier otra interacción, es decir, nunca se crea ni se destruye, solo se intercambia. Aunque en algunos casos, solo pequeños cambios en la cantidad de movimiento, especialmente en la dirección vertical, puede tener resultados poco favorables, como nos demuestra nuestro incompetente favorito, Julian Palmer.
Similar mass get involved in a collision. The resulting change in velocity affects both objects in similar ways. Not that it makes it any easier to slow down the resulting wreckage. On the contrary, if there's a big difference in mass between two colliding objects, the smaller object will change its speed considerably, while the larger object will barely budge, especially a lorry and a bike. Because it is an algebraic sum of momentum, so one of them remains constant, in most problems it's in two dimensions. And in those cases, it is useful to think of them as complex numbers. You see here. And compute them with that method as complex numbers. That way, you get a useful result for both components in pretty much a single number. And you can use some really simple formulas to figure out the magnitude and angle of any momentum magnitude.
Por supuesto que cualquier cambio en la cantidad de movimiento requiere algún objeto adicional a ocupar tras el movimiento. Usualmente esto se logra con un buen agarre a una superficie plana o pseudoplana. Sin embargo, debido a la inercia, una vez perdido el agarre, el objeto en cuestión seguirá moviéndose hasta encontrar una superficie que le proporcione agarre o un muro que lo detenga. Cuando la cantidad de movimiento se pierde en un lapso muy pequeño, lo más favorable es alargar ese lapso para disminuir el daño provocado al cuerpo.
Over half of the controlled crumpling work is done by a pair of steel rails connecting the front bumper to the body, which bend and deform to absorb energy and slow the car. Most, and in ideal circumstances all, of the rest of the energy is absorbed by the deformation of other pieces of structural metal throughout the front of the car.
This is especially true in Formula One cars. Not only is the nose crunchable, the tires are made pretty much so that they would snap in case of a collision with another car or with a wall. Which is probably the reason why Julian Palmer is still alive. Although the car itself will inevitably end up rather ruined.
Esperemos que les haya gustado este video.
Denle pulgar arriba y suscríbanse.
Nos vemos hasta la próxima.